Good morning, Redeemer. Once again, with you virtually, which is a little weird, but we obviously have some good news of late. Like, it sounds like we're going to start moving towards being able to have church again. So hopefully in the next couple of weeks, we'll actually be able to, as a body, get together and worship our Lord and Savior. But as today, as we start, we're going to look at Psalm 62, 5 through 8 as our call to worship, and it'll be on your screen. So if you want to read along with me, that'd be awesome. For God alone, O my soul, wait in silence, for my hope is from him. He only is my rock and my salvation, my fortress. I shall not be shaken. On God rests my salvation and my glory. My mighty rock, my refuge is God. Trust in all at all times, O people. Pour out your hearts before him. God is a refuge for us.
How deep the Father's love for us, how vast beyond all measure, that he should give his only son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss, the turns his face away as wounds which mar the chosen one bring many sons to glory. Behold, I will not boast in anything, no gifts, no power, no wisdom, but I will boast in Jesus Christ, his death and resurrection.
Good morning, Redeemer. We have several announcements this week, all of which can also be found in the weekly Redeemer email. There you will find the links and the addresses and the phone numbers that you need, so check out your email box this week. I wanted to begin by bringing up two celebrations that we have within our church community. The first one is for David and Katie Magnuson, and we are celebrating them via a virtual shower by sending words of encouragement through text, email, or snail mail. And you can also contribute in the church group gift by contacting Haley Kramer. She can take Venmo if you have that, or you can contact her with questions via email or text. We're also going to be celebrating the upcoming wedding of Tanner Krogman and Casey Bruns, and Jen Heinrichs is coordinating the group gift for that. Please contact her by May 8th and send your words of encouragement to them. Recently, we had a family birthday for Amani, and I just know that any words were so encouraging to her and to our family, and so never underestimate the power of a simple text or email. Also, we wanted to give you an update on the Nunn family. Miss Rosie had surgery this week to replace the bone fragment from her skull that had been taken out earlier, and the surgery went well. She is going to return to Madonna on Monday, so just continue to pray for them as she recovers and as the Nunn family supports her. Also, at this time, we would like to bless them with a particular special gift of backyard landscaping and a playground for Mother's Day. So if you would like to contribute to that financially, you can send a check to Brett West. His address is in the weekly email. Or if you have any questions about that, just contact him. A few things that we have still going on during the week for Redeemer include a men's Bible study and prayer. The men's Bible study is held on Monday nights at 7:30 via Zoom and is coordinated by Phil Autry. If you are not able to connect on Monday nights and would still like to do a Bible study, please contact Phil because he's kind of feeling it out whether or not another night would be beneficial for Redeemer. He'll base that on the response, so just get a hold of him. And as far as prayer meetings, we have one every day each week from 12 to 12:15, and then on Sundays from 9:45 to 10:15 before church. So if you would like to join any of those, you can connect with the Zoom link that's found online on our website or on the weekly Redeemer email. Finally, we wanted to send out a special thank you to everyone for their continued support of Redeemer and the work of the church. Your generosity at this uncertain time has been amazing and overwhelming to us. Please know also that we are transitioning at this time to a less expensive mode of online giving called Stripe. And while our existing platform is still up and running, we encourage everybody to transition over to Stripe. You can do so by connecting with the link on Welcome to Redeemer on our website, or check out the link on the weekly Redeemer email. Thanks so much for listening and hope you have a great day.
Brighter in us, so we may you and Good morning, Redeemer. It's a pleasure to be with you. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Thomas Kuhn. I'm the RUF campus minister at UNL. It's good to be with you and to be able to bring the word to you in this time. So I don't know about you, but I've been on a lot of Zoom calls recently. I was actually counting on the way over here, and I think I've been in 10 different Zoom calls this week. It's a pretty normal week, but one in particular, I was in a Zoom call with, it was related to work, and we had probably 15 to 20 people in there, and the guy who was heading up the Zoom call started talking about how during this time, we've all been experiencing a lot of losses. We all have lots of things that we could be sad about. And so he started talking about there being like micro losses, like my favorite restaurant is closed, and macro losses of, you know, we can't get together for church, or someone in my family passed away and we can't have a funeral. And he encouraged us to take some time to sit down and to write out some of these losses that we're experiencing, and then we're going to share them with the group. And so I sat down, you know, in my office at home, and it was pretty easy for me to think of some of these things. The first one that came to mind is, well, I can't go out to eat. Really love going out to eat. Can't do that anymore. I can't hug anyone. I've never really been much of a hugger, but for some reason, I feel like that's something I'm missing out on right now. I can't go to church. My wife and I had to cancel a trip that we've been planning for 4 years. And there were lots of things that came to mind, and I imagine you sitting at home, you can probably think of losses that you've experienced as well. But more than anything else, as we were doing this exercise together, as we were thinking through these micro and macro losses, I couldn't stop thinking to myself, I hate this. I hate this. I don't hate the fact that these losses are happening. I don't hate the fact that I'm sad. I hate the fact that we're talking about it. I'm sick of talking about sadness. I hate naming the losses I feel. Like, what's the point? We're all experiencing this sadness, and no matter what we do, it's not going to go away. So why in the world would we be sad about it? And also, you kind of start comparing relatively. You know, there are people out there who are way more affected by this than me, and they're okay. So I should be okay too, right? I don't need to talk about it. Have any of you ever felt this way over the past couple weeks? How are you dealing with the sadness that you're experiencing right now? Because you're experiencing sadness in one way or another. Maybe you're not tempted to angrily deny it like me. Maybe you cover it up with positive thinking. How many of us in this time have said things like, you know, God is too good for me to worry about my sadness? Or we've kind of hit ourselves with different Bible verses when we're starting to feel sad. Or maybe we've said things to ourselves like, well, you know, we need to focus on this time as an opportunity and not as a problem. Or maybe you don't cover it up with positive thinking. Maybe you attempt to numb your sadness. We can do this through lots of different ways. Maybe it's eating, drinking too much. Maybe it's dreaming about a return to normalcy. Like, oh, thank God, whenever this will be over. Maybe it's overworking. I saw a statistic that Americans since quarantine began have worked more than they did before. Or maybe you take it out on your loved ones. I don't know about you, but has anyone else noticed an uptick in their irritability recently? Like the things about your spouse that were like an adorable quirk, or the thing about your children that were endearing, are now like an absolute declaration of war. Like, has anyone else noticed that your spouse's chewing is really annoying? I never noticed before this. So what do we do with our sadness? The point I'm trying to make here is that we do something with it. And this is where this psalm that we're going to be looking at this morning, Psalm 13, this is where it meets us in this question of what do we do with our sadness? And for those of you who are unfamiliar with the psalms, the psalms are the hymn book of the Old Testament people of God. They're kind of the songbook that the people of God throughout the ages would get together and sing and remind each other of what is true. And 40% of the psalms are sad songs. They're laments. A lament is basically, it's just laying a troubled situation before the Lord and asking him for help. And 40% of the psalms, these songs that Jewish people sang, the songs that Jesus grew up singing, are about sadness. So the question today, as we look at Psalm chapter 13, we're going to ask, what do we do with our sadness? What do we do with our sadness? I got 3 points for us. First, we can name it. Second, we can cry out for help. And third, we can move forward in trust. So we can name it, we can cry out for help, and we can move forward in trust. So I'm going to read Psalm 13 for us, and I'll pray, and we can get started. So Psalm 13. How long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? How long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? How long shall my enemy be exalted over me? Consider and answer me, O Lord my God. Light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death, lest my enemy say I have prevailed over him, lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken. But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. Let's pray together. Our Father, as we turn to your word, Lord, we are all bringing sadnesses. We're all bringing things that we're sad about. And we're all dealing with that in various ways. But Lord, your word shows us a way forward. And I pray that you would give us courage to take a look at our own sadness. And Lord, that you would open our eyes that we might see you clearly. And all these things I ask in Jesus' name. Amen. So what do we do with our sadness? First off, we can name it. We can name it. And right from the get-go in this psalm, we see in verse 1, it opens with this question, how long, O Lord? And it actually says this four times in the first couple verses. And literally in the original language, it says, it's very abrupt. It just says, until when? Like, until when? Like, how long is this going to keep happening? We see in verse 1, it says, how long, O Lord, will you forget me forever? How long will you hide your face from me? We see here that this is a spiritual sadness, a sadness that feels like God has rejected him. It kind of reminds me of how maybe if you've had an argument with your spouse, it can go from like 0 to 100 really quick. Like you're just talking about something innocuous, and then all of a sudden you're like, do you even respect me? Like, what's going on? Like, that seems like what's going on here. It's not that he has like some minor beef with the Lord. He says that he has forgotten him. How long will you hide your face from me? David here feels distance between him and God. And then we see in verse 2, it says, how long must I take counsel in my soul and have sorrow in my heart all the day? We see here that it's not just a spiritual sadness here. There's like this deep emotional experience of sadness. There's loneliness, anxiety, despair. It says that he is taking counsel in his soul. And what that means is he's just mulling over these thoughts all day long. He's basically saying, how long am I going to have to be my own therapist? How long am I going to have to be utterly and completely alone in what I'm feeling? And then he goes on in the second part of verse 2, how long shall my enemy be exalted over me? And so this psalm was written by King David, who's kind of like the prototype of the Israelite. He was the great king of God's people, and he would have had enemies. At one point, his son was trying to have him killed. At one point, King Saul was trying to have him killed. He had lots of enemies. But here in this psalm, it doesn't actually say specifically what enemy he's talking about, and I think that's intentional. I think it's so that we can imagine ourselves in this psalm, so that we can pick it up and use it for ourselves. See, David is naming his sadness before God in this psalm. He's calling it like he sees it. But an important thing to note about the psalms, this is not King David's private prayer journal. This is actually a song that was sung in church. It was a song that we would sing together. We're invited here together as the people of God to name our sadness. We're invited to call it like it is. But you might be out there thinking, as I'm talking about this, what's the point? Like, why in the world should we name our sadness? It's not going to change anything. And I wonder, if that's you, do you use the same line of thinking in your other relationships? I mean, think with me if you're married. In our marriages, do we think this same way? Actually, in our marriages, we argue with our spouse or we talk about the things that we're sad about precisely because we love them. We tell them when we feel missed, because we know that they need, that we need to know each other, that we need to hear each other. You see, a happy marriage is not the absence of conflict, but it's the ability to stay committed and connected to each other in the midst of conflict. So if you want intimacy with your spouse, the way forward is to acknowledge the disagreement, to acknowledge the sadness, to work it out. See, to name what is actually going on, to name the ways that you feel hurt, to name the ways that you feel overlooked, is a sign of intimacy. And the same is true of our relationship with God. Intimacy with God is not refusing to talk about our sadness. No, it is talking about our sadness boldly before him. It's telling him what we feel. So maybe you're here and you're still thinking, okay, like I hear you, but what's the point of talking about it? It's not going to change anything. Like my situation is still pretty terrible. Why talk about it? But what if your deepest need is not a change of situation, but a change of heart? What if God doesn't want you to suck it up? What if he wants to walk through it with you? If this is you, I'd ask you, where in your life are you avoiding this question of how long? Where in your life are you avoiding naming your sadness? But maybe that's not you. Maybe you're on the other side and you're thinking, well, you know, God is so good, I shouldn't complain. I shouldn't complain about anything going wrong in my life. If that's you, you want to rush to verse 6 that says, I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me. You don't want to deal with the first couple verses. You just want to talk about praising God. Counselor Dan Allender says this. He says, our refusal to embrace our sadness is often an attempt to escape the agony of childbirth and build up the illusion of a safe world. It's an attempt to deal with a God who does not relieve our pain. It's an attempt to deal with a God who does not relieve our pain. What if God is so good that he doesn't relieve our pain? What if God is so good that he is okay with you telling him when you don't feel cared for by him? What if God doesn't need you to hide what you're going through? What if instead he wants to come to you and sit with you in the sadness? So we see here that we're invited to name our sadness, to be honest about it. But not only that, we can also cry out for help. We can cry out for help. If you would look with me to verse 3, David then moves on and says, consider and answer me, O Lord my God. And so we move from naming things to all of a sudden demanding things of God. We can tell this is demanding because these words consider and answer, they're in the imperative. It's like a command. It's like God, he's basically saying, look at me. Look at me. He said he felt forgotten by God earlier, and here he is saying, look at me. Because he knows the only solution for feeling forgotten by God is for God to remember him. And so that's exactly what he asks for. But then he says in the latter part of verse 3, he says, light up my eyes, lest I sleep the sleep of death. We see here that he kind of feels like he feels dead, and he wants God to give him life. He wants God to comfort him. He's saying, meet me in my sorrow and give me hope. And then he says in verse 4, lest my enemy say I have prevailed over him, lest my foes rejoice because I am shaken. It's as if he's arguing with God here. Like it's moved even further. He's basically saying to God, he said, listen, here's the rub. If you don't save me, people are going to know that you didn't save me, and it's going to look bad on you. And he's like, yeah, it's kind of your deal, God. What are you going to do with it? He's arguing with him. So how do we feel about this sort of bold demanding in this situation, right? If it was hard for us to see the first part where he's just naming what's going on with God, how much more difficult is it to see this like bold demanding of God? In the New Testament, Jesus actually tells a story of a man who makes a similar bold demand. He tells a story of a man who has a friend who arrives after a long journey at midnight. And so his friend comes after this long journey. He would have been hot, sweaty. He would have been tired. He would have been really hungry. And it was traditional in that culture for if you have a friend showing up at your house to give him something to drink, to give him something to eat. And the problem is that this man realized as soon as his friend arrives that he has no bread. He has nothing to give him. And in a hospitality culture, this would have been a huge deal. This is like the peak of shame, not being able to provide for your guests. And so after the man realizes he has no bread, his solution is to go bang on his neighbor's door. And this is at midnight. He goes and bangs on his neighbor's door, and he asks him for bread. And you can imagine his neighbor's probably like, come on, man, like I've got kids in here trying to sleep. Like, what are you doing? But then he keeps knocking on the door asking for bread. And finally, the neighbor gives in and gives him bread. And so Jesus tells this story. And if you're anything like me, you are just waiting for Jesus to let this guy have it in the story. Like, see, don't be annoying like him. Be nice and don't ever ask for anything from anyone. But no, that's not what Jesus says at all. After telling this story, Jesus goes on to say that this man's persistence in knocking and asking for what he needs is exactly how we should be in praying for our needs. Jesus lifts up this annoying, persistent knocker as a model for how we should talk to God. And how does that hit you? Some of us might think that praying in this way is annoying to God. That having a bold request, that asking God to comfort us, to care for us, is annoying to God. And if that's you, I hear you. I feel that too. Yet I also wonder where you got that idea. How we respond to the idea of making bold requests of God shows who we actually think God is. If we think that this is annoying to request things of God, then we probably think that God is annoyed by our needs. If we get angry at this, we probably think it's because God is angered by our needs. But what we see in Scripture is something completely different. We see a God who is our Father, a God who invites us to cry out to him, a God who doesn't expect us to know what to do and who is eager to run to us and give us exactly what we need. You see, the good news here is that we are invited to cry out to God for help. We can ask for exactly what we need. We don't have to deny our need. We don't have to shut it down. No, we can go directly to the source and ask for what we need in our sadness. But not only can we cry out for help, we can also move forward in trust. And this is verses 5 and 6 here. So we've seen thus far, we name our sadness. We boldly ask for God to help us. And then finally, in verses 5 and 6, we can move forward in trust. Verses 5 and 6 say, "But I have trusted in your steadfast love. My heart shall rejoice in your salvation. I will sing to the Lord because he has dealt bountifully with me." And if you pay attention, just kind of scanning through the psalm, this is a pretty drastic change in tone. Like we're kind of dealing with, I mean, the first part of this song sounds a little bit like a modern day Kesha song. And the last part sounds kind of like an old Kesha song. Maybe two of you will get that joke, but it's a good one, I promise. There's a change in tone here. But we have no indication that the situation has changed. So how do we respond to that? How can we get from this place of naming our sadness, of being in deep sadness, to moving forward in trust? Like, what do we do with this change? And for some of us, moving from sadness to trust is really difficult. Like, if I'm feeling abandoned by God, how in the world am I supposed to trust him? Like, some of us love the first couple verses of this, of naming everything that's wrong, but we hate the idea of having to trust God. But then others of us, we get to verses 5 and 6 and we're like, thank God that is over. I am sick of talking about all this sadness. Can you people quit whining? Suck it up. Let's move on and talk about how awesome God is. But what we see here in this psalm is that the joy that we see at the end, this trust, this joyful reliance on God is not possible without engaging sadness. One of my favorite authors and preachers, Zach Eswine, says, "It is an act of faith and wisdom to be sad about sad things." And I think the opposite is true. It's also an act of foolishness not to be sad about sad things. See, sadness is actually part of the Christian story. I mean, we can remember this, especially as we're in this season of Easter. We celebrate Lent, This 40-day fast, we celebrate Good Friday, commemorating the day when Jesus was crucified, and we celebrate Holy Saturday every year. And these are all sad days. We sit in our sadness, and yet we eagerly anticipate the joy of Easter Sunday. You see, death and resurrection are inherent parts of the Christian story. Every week we worship in the name of one who is known as a man of sorrows, who is well acquainted with grief. You see, the Christian hope is not sidestepping sadness. It's moving through sadness into resurrection joy. And it is precisely through the naming our sadness and crying out to God that we are enabled to move forward and trust. And as we do that, we can see in our sadness that we are brought closer to Jesus and we can grow in our faith. You see, Jesus experienced the sadness of Psalm 13 to the uttermost. Jesus knew what it was like for God to forget him. He knew what it was like to be utterly alone in emotional distress. He knew what it was like for his enemies to gloat over him. And in dealing with our sadness, we can begin to know the heart of Jesus, who was a man of sorrows. We can better understand the one who did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant. You see, as we engage with our own sadness, as we name what's actually going on, we can know our servant King Jesus better. But not only that, in the story of Jesus' sadness, we can get a taste of how our sadness will end. You see, Jesus' sadness ended in glory, and so will ours. Jesus' sadness ended in the glory of resurrection, the glory of lost and ruined sinners being brought home, the glory of restored creation, and ultimately the glory of everything sad coming untrue. And as we find companionship with Jesus in our sadness, we can also rejoice and long for the day that we will experience the fullness of resurrection joy. And if God can bring joy out of Jesus' sadness, what sadness is there in our lives that he can't redeem? Let's pray. Our Father, we thank you for Psalm 13. We thank you that you invite us to name our sadness before you, that you invite us to cry out for help, and you invite us to move forward in trust. Lord, I pray for all of us, those of us listening at home, Lord, that we would find fellowship with you. Lord, that we would find fellowship with you in our sadness and that we would be able to hope in the resurrection, the true hope. All these things I ask in Jesus' name, amen.
Well, as we come to a time in our service where we're going to do a little bit of confessing, I mean, what a great message by Thomas. And just you think about even the sadness he's talking about, even the sadness we come oftentimes to this point where we are stuck in our sins. We are so aggravated by the fact that we can't get through them and it's habitual. And as we look at this passage, as we pray together and think through about our sin, we're going to take a moment, just where we get to take a moment and actually bring that to God, right? Name that to God and be able to trust in him, Lord, him in a second. So let's do this. This is our prayer together. So I think it will be on the screen, on your TV screen, I should say. But let's use this as our prayer together, and then we'll take a moment in silence, and I'll bring us back. But Almighty and most merciful Father, you call us to pour out our hearts before you, for you are a refuge for us. You say that you are near to the brokenhearted, and so often we run from acknowledging our brokenness. We have erred and strayed from your ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much with devices and desires of our own hearts. We have broken your holy laws. We have left undone that which we ought to have done. We have done things which we ought not to have done. But you, O Lord, have mercy upon us according to your steadfast love. Confirm to us the promise that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Amen. So let's take a moment now and just in silence pray where you're at on your couch, wherever you're at, and then I'll bring us back here in a second. Dear Lord, we just thank you so much for the fact that you are merciful to us, and we are people who sin and sin often, and oftentimes it's the same sins we are constantly struggling with and constantly unwilling to give up to you. And I just thank you for the fact that you love us and you died on a cross so that those sins will never be counted against us because we stand perfect because of the blood of your Son, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen. In Psalms 103:8-13, it's an assurance of forgiveness today. So I just want you to listen to this and hear this. The Lord is merciful and gracious, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love. He will not always chide, nor will he keep his anger forever. He does not deal with us according to our sins, nor repay us according to our iniquities. For as high as the heavens are above the earth, so great is his steadfast love towards those who fear him. So far as the east is from the west, so does he remove our transgressions from us. As a father shows compassion to his children, so the Lord shows compassion to those who fear him. Amen. So here's the Lord's benediction today. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit you may abound in hope. Amen.